bi-weekly. Today we have founder Charlotte Melkert from eCulture, hosted by Daria from WeShare. The session will be recorded, so if you don't want to be on the recording, please turn off your camera. Also, please for now mute your microphone during this, so there will be enough opportunity to ask questions. And Daria will let you guys know when it's the appropriate time, and you can always put it in the chat. So for now, Daria, kick it off.
Yes. Well, welcome everyone to our first digital edition of Startup Tuesday The Hague. Today in this edition, I will host it and I will interview wonderful Charlotte from eCulture. The reason why we invited Charlotte is because she is an expert in remote work. And I think all of us would appreciate some tips and trips on this topic. So welcome, Charlotte, to this session. First of all, please introduce yourself and tell us a bit more about what you do and about your company.
Yeah, so thanks, by the way, guys, everyone who's joining today. My name is Charlotte. I am one of the founders of eCulture, which is a startup based in Rotterdam here in the Netherlands. We offer a predictive hiring software for companies. So by using more data into the recruitment process, we help companies in making better hiring decisions, more objective hiring decisions, and more based on data rather than gut feeling. So although we are a company that tends to focus more on selection rather than what to do when your team is in, but now since the coronavirus is happening and a lot of companies are struggling with remote working, including our own clients, we received the question from I think 10-20 clients, like, how can we some sort of misuse your product and all the data you normally use to see if a candidate is a good fit with a job? How can we use that same data to make sure that our team is ready for a remote working setting? So mm-hmm. We changed our product a little bit. So now we are helping companies also in how to measure the 8 skills that have proven to be crucial when your team is working fully remotely. Of course, a lot of companies are dealing already with some remote working, but the entire office being remote is quite new for most of us. So what are the skills that are really crucial for that? How can you actually measure that skills? And we provide companies with very easy recommendations to improve those skills even next day, or at least help people get used to those to mastering those skills as soon as possible. Since, of course, it's now a really crucial topic, and we see that it's affecting a lot of their company's productivity as well. So yeah, normally focus more on hiring, but now since the coronavirus is happening, we really pivoted ourselves towards remote hiring expertise for companies. Still need to get used to the two terms, because we now have hiring, remote hiring, and remote working.
Oh wow.
We have all three of them now.
Thank you. So let's speak more in general. How has your business have been impacted by the corona outbreak? What have changed so far in your team, in the business model in general?
Well, like I said, we are a predictive hiring software. So that means that our business model is also based on the hiring needs of companies. Funnily enough, we were already making the transition towards more focus on the team itself. So remotely was a forced opportunity to do it really fast, which is the name of the remote working tool. But yeah, we have a business model based on how many job openings you have live on our platform. So of course, we were impacted as well by the coronavirus. We work for a lot of scale-ups, especially. We also have some corporate clients, but many scale-up clients, because we see that they benefit from our product right away. And I think it's skilled are really cool companies to work with. And I think that unfortunately, the younger the company is, the more you're likely to suffer also financially from what's happening. Yeah. So we experienced definitely some churn. Some customers with a hiring freeze. And I think it's completely normal that's happening. But so far, so good. It's actually less than we expected it to be. I see a lot of companies are and including us as well, are also very quite struggling with, okay, how long is the situation going to take? Do we need to just put some decision making on hold for maybe a month or 2 months, or do we need to get used to the fact that this is going to be the way of working for the coming months? And I think that that's the issue we experience as well. So we made the decision, we just go for it. We are keep doing it, keep running our business the way we used to run it, keep following our forecast, etc. But I think that's quite of a struggle that many companies are experiencing now. And of course, remote working, practice what you preach, but we also need to learn a lot about remote working. We were used to some remote working, but not the entire team. So I think the last 2 weeks, me and my co-founder also really took the time to make sure that everyone is really ready for that, that we have all the equipment ready, that people are getting comfortable to the new situation. So I think the challenges that 99% of all companies are facing, we are facing them as well.
Yeah, okay. And you mentioned it a bit before, but what has been the experience of your clients of scale-ups? So what have been their changes in a sense? Do they hire more? Do they hire less?
I think really depending on the business model, of course, some companies are really suffering from the coronavirus depending on the industry in which you are. So, for instance, we have some clients with restaurant apps or stuff like that. Unfortunately, a lot of that, those companies are really on hold. So it really depends on the business model.
Industry, yeah.
And the industry, of course, you also have a lot of companies that are doing a look at, for instance, we are now using Google Hangouts today, but the companies like Zoom, now that everyone needs to video chat with each other. There are a lot of companies that are still hiring a lot. So it's a bit 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
I do not see a lot of layoffs, fortunately. I expected that, to be honest, as well, but I haven't seen that with our customers so far. I think that people are just more conscious about the decisions they make. And I think for more than half of the scale-ups, that definitely means that they are hiring less or maybe even not. But I don't know how that's been for everyone that's joining the call today, but I see that we are now in the third week, if I say it correctly, of being remotely and all the, let's say, the chaos level of Corona. I think that the first 2 weeks were really a chaos for many companies. And I think now we are slowly getting our feet on the ground again. And we came up with some sort of a battle plan to make sure that we actually keep our head up during this time. So I see that happening as well. And it's also really, really amazing to see how many companies find a way to pivot their business model very quickly. Mm-hmm. I spoke to my co-founder spoke to a guy last week who said this is some sort of the wipeout for entrepreneurship now, which entrepreneurs are going to be the creative ones finding a way to pivot their company towards a situation that allows them to grow in the situation, and which companies are down under basically by what's happening. So it's
can you give any examples of such companies, maybe without naming them, but what kind of change did they make in their business model?
Well, I think everyone is making quite a lot of changes to get the best out of it. So, of course, we did it as well with our product, just pivoted towards a remote working product. I see companies in retail doing really cool stuff to make sure that people who are normally more focused on offline selling can promote their products better online. You see people giving away some stuff. Companies like parking software that are giving their software for free to nurses and those kinds of employment forms to make sure that they can park for free. It's really funny to see how everyone is trying to find a way to see, okay, is there out of the 10 things I do with my company, can I just pick one thing that works now? And can I twist it in a way that it works now for people? And I think for most companies, there is actually a way to pivot yourself. Mm-hmm. That's very stimulating to and inspiring to see around me.
Yeah. And going back to the topic of HR industry, so since you are an expert in this, what changes do you foresee in the nearest future? So what will change for the people who look for a job, or what will change for the people, for the companies who are planning to hire? Can you foresee already any trends?
Well, I think there is One thing that definitely will be happening is that everyone needs to get used to the fact of remote hiring. Now, for everyone that keeps hiring, you need to make sure that your process is ready for doing it fully remotely. So I think that's going to provide some opportunities as well, because if people are now experiencing like, hey, remote working is actually pretty fine once you have it under control, maybe that allows you also to start hiring people working remotely after the corona crisis. So I think that's a really nice opportunity, because of course remote hiring allows you to have a way larger talent pool as well. So I think that's a really positive takeaway that we can get out of this crisis. We are really forced to innovate in our hiring as well.
Yeah.
I think after the coronavirus, we have two options. I think one of them is that people, let's hope that the coronavirus is getting under control, and that within 2-3 months companies are taking up from the point where they actually left it, and that maybe it's even start hiring faster because they have a forecast or a hiring schedule and they want to keep up to speed again, or the consequences for the economy are huge and you see that all companies are slowing down all the costs they make in the investments. And I think that will definitely not mean that hiring stops, but at least that people will consider a hiring decision more than they do it right now. So I think depending on how long the situation is going to take, even we have a marathon of people trying to keep up to speed again, or people stay really conscious with their hiring practices.
And what recommendations do you have for job seekers, for example, now, or companies which are planning to hire new personnel at this time?
Well, for companies planning to hire new people, the most important one, of course, get your hiring ready for a remote setting. We all see it. We are all working remotely now. It's really different from what we're used to. And if you are hiring people, you have another dimension. So you don't only need to keep up to speed with your current team, your internal team, but you also need to include a candidate into that process. So how are you going to manage your communication both internally and externally? So I think that's going to be a tough challenge for companies. Can I get my process up to speed as fast as possible to actually make that happen? For job seekers, I don't know how many opportunities there are out there for now. We see in our platform a slight decrease of the amount of jobs. So yeah, I think it's maybe too soon to say something valuable for job seekers. I think for companies themselves, this is also the time to really start focusing on the team you have right now. So I think hiring will definitely be a priority for a lot of companies still, but I think it's now more important than ever to take a look at your current team and make sure that they get the most value, that you get the most value out of the people you have right now in your company.
Okay, so that's exactly what I would like to speak about more right now. So remote working, let's talk about that. Isn't it easy? You just set up Trello or Slack account and you just start? Like, what is the problem here?
Well, I think that it's actually quite fascinating, because when we started having conversations with a lot of startups and skill founders, we asked them about their remote working challenge. What do you think will be a problem for your company if this is going to stay for at least a few months? The first reaction is from most of the companies is always like, I already have a Slack channel, I have some software for video calls, we have colleagues that working from home 1 day a week or 2 days a week. So I think it should be fine. We have everything said and done. I think the pitfall that many companies are experiencing right now, because now we are 2.5 weeks further, so you now will experience the impact of remote working, is that remote working is not about having the right tool stack. It's about how to make sure that your team keeps synced, that your team keeps working well together, that it keeps communicating, that different teams won't lose track of each other's work and social contact. So I think the challenges are way more focused on the person in your team rather than, do I have the right tools and do my employees have a second screen at home to work comfortably. So I think that's a real challenge that many companies still tend to underestimate.
So do you believe that all people have different remote working skills then?
Well, I think, of course, when we decided to launch remotely, that's the name of the initiative that we started. We interviewed a lot of Scope founders, and we basically read all the research online about remote working. And there are skills that are proven to be crucial for remote working. And it doesn't mean that if your team member doesn't have one of those skills, it doesn't mean that you're unsuccessful in remote working, but at least you should be aware of what you master and what you don't master. So for instance, if you have a team member that's not working so well independently, or is not so self-reliant, or if one of your team members really struggles with work prioritizing or planning or whatever, it can eventually really, really bite your company. And that doesn't mean that those people are unsuccessful. You just need to give them some help to make sure that they can use those skills the right way to keep up to speed. And I think that's what we are now slowly starting to realize. That if you want to stay productive as a company, you really need to focus on, okay, where do my different team members need some help from me? Instead of, do we have a Slack channel for each different team? Do we have some video call software so that they can continue their sales meetings, for instance?
And you mentioned 8 remote work skills. Could you name them and also say how can any of us assess ourselves if we have all of them?
Well, let me provide with some examples. So, for instance, a very, very easy one to tackle as well, work prioritizing. It can be, especially in, for instance, sales roles or support roles or whatever, it can be a really big pitfall if you don't master work prioritizing, because there's a lot on your plate. You need to, you have a lot of different tasks on a weekly basis. So how to make sure that you always work on the right things? Well, what we did for that skill, for instance, is we created some sort of a matrix for companies where team members first need to write down all their to-dos. So if I'm a business developer, for instance, these are my 10 to-dos for this week. And then try to categorize them. So what you can do, for instance, as a really practical tip, try to look at 2 different angles of tasks that your team members are doing. One angle is it a high impact task or a low impact task? And by impact, I mean, to what extent does it contribute to your team's KPIs and team's goal settings of that month? Mm-hmm. And on the other dimension, is it a really urgent task or is it not that urgent? So if you look at, for instance, a business developer, emailing back a prospect or calling back a client as a support employee is not contributing significantly to your team KPIs, but it's really urgent, because if you wait for it for a week, then your client will become unhappy, or your prospect won't convert to client. So that's, for instance, how you can deal with that. What you can also do is things like, if you tend to focus more on short-term achievements than long-term focus. What we've seen is that if you work fully remotely with your whole team and you are more focused on short-term achievements rather than long-term focus, you can easily lose the bigger picture of the company that you're working for.
Yeah.
So try to make sure that you are very clear with your management team, okay, what is our company's vision, what's your company's mission? I think that everyone should have that statement, or should come up with it now that we are working remotely. How do we translate that mission we have into the goal settings of different teams? And how can I make sure that I remember my people every day, even if they are doing a really small task, how it's contributing to the team goal setting and eventually the mission and the vision we have? So those are really practical tips, and I think it's not that hard to implement, because it should be easy to implement, because the problem is very crucial right now. But these are just some tips and tricks to make sure you get up and running a bit more quicker than you normally would. And of course, besides of mastering certain skills, it's maybe even more important to make sure that your team stays happy as well. Because remote working is definitely not something that everyone likes. I think actually that most people don't like remote working. But you still need to keep up the team spirit. People need to stay motivated in these times, especially when it's now, it's an uncertain time for companies. It's an uncertain time for people privately, because maybe we have people around us suffering from the coronavirus as well. So it's extremely important to make sure that your team keeps inspired every day, to keep your job and keeps motivated to keep working together. And we see for our clients that two things are very important for that. One of that is being aware of what the rest of the team is doing. So if your company is split into different teams, so for instance, we here internally, we have a development team, we have a sales team, we have a support team. Make sure that they all know from each other what they are working on. So maybe you can do something with a weekly check-in, for instance. We internally here call it the weekly, which we have two times a week right now, in which every team shortly explains what they are working on, so that everyone keeps in the loop and knows what's happening in other departments. And another one, which is very important, is social interaction. So how do you make sure that people still get interacting with not only their direct colleagues, but also their indirect colleagues? We saw that as well in our team. We are quite a small team with 13 people, but it already became a challenge to make sure that the product team also drinks a cup of coffee with the sales team or the CS team, for instance. So,
and how do you ensure that they keep in touch?
Well, very practical tip, and for us it's working great so far. We are using Slack for our internal communications. So what we did, and we use Google Hangouts for our video calls. So what we did is we created a Slack channel called Coffee, and we put a Google Hangouts link into that channel. And if you are grabbing a coffee at home, or if you want to drink a beer at the end of the day or whatever, you can just Slack is someone in the coffee link, or you can just have the coffee link open on your laptop and just put your camera and your mic off, for instance. And then where normally you would have a chat where you are literally grabbing a cup of coffee at the coffee machine, now when I'm grabbing a coffee after lunch or at the end of the day when I'm grabbing a beer, I just say, hey guys, is someone up for a coffee or a beer, whatever. To have that small chat, and we see that it actually works, that people really stay interacted with each other and like the fact that they keep in touch with each other. So that's really working. And I think my last tip, because I'm talking very long now without letting you ask any questions, be transparent to your team. This is definitely not the time to not being transparent. It's okay for your team to know what's happening now. It's okay for your team to know that business is running maybe not so well. What do you expect for the coming months? How is it impacting the business, and how are you planning to react on that? It's now more important than ever to keep your employees in the loop, because no one is, we are not foolish. We know what's happening in the world. Being transparent and open keeps them involved, and not sharing anything will only make them conscious about what's going to happen. And eventually, maybe even people leaving because they are scared that your company will go bankrupt or whatever in a really extreme scenario. So transparency is now more important than ever.
Yeah, of course. And I can also add to what you said about keep the team spirit high. Just before this talk, I received a message from my friend. She works for one company in Amsterdam, and they have offices in Amsterdam, Rotterdam, and other cities in Europe. And she sent me the picture that she just received a cake from her company, delivered to her
house.
So, and she was so surprised to receive it with a letter of appreciation from her company that we didn't forget you, we're still a team. It's just such a small gesture, but it changes so much that you still feel connected.
I always tend to look at the positive things of these kinds of situations, because being negative is not going to help here. I think the very positive outcome of Corona should be for every company that normally it's just daily business. You keep running as an entrepreneur, and you tend to focus less on the achievements you've made for that week and the people you have in your team. I think this is a moment where you really need to reflect on your team members and how they are actually getting you through this crisis. At least for me, it really does. Our team is working incredibly hard to make sure that we can keep running and do everything well and get in touch with our customers, etc. It's team is more important than ever now, and I hope that's really really an eye opener for companies out there. And also my last tip, try to really celebrate each success, because of course times can be so negative now for especially companies that are hit quite hard by the coronavirus, that every success is one you should celebrate. So we sold our first customer for our new product last week, and it was really a small amount of money we get out of that. But hey, we launched the product in 1 week as a response to the coronavirus, and it actually worked out. So we are going to celebrate it. And those are things that keep your team motivated now.
Could you actually expand more and talk more about this new product? So you launched remotely. Why did you do it? And what is it exactly?
Well, why we did it, like I said, our company is really focused on helping scaling companies in building the right teams to scale. And a very important aspect of our product is that we have included gamified assessments into our platform, measuring key skills and personalities that can predict to which extent you fit a certain job and a certain company. Mm-hmm. We use that games to benchmark your current team. So what do you have in your current team in terms of skills and personalities, and therefore what can you add to your team to make it a better team? And we use those same games to assess candidates coming in for your job openings. So every candidate that's responding to your job opening plays the gamified assessments to learn more about skills and personality. What we heard from many companies already 2 weeks ago, many of our customers, is that they said like, okay, maybe I cannot use your product for hiring that intensive now, but you have that games measuring skills and personality. So isn't there a way to some sort of misuse those games for now? And see how I can get the best out of my current team now, rather than looking for new people to join the team. So that was really an eye opener for us. Like, okay, yeah, we can actually pivot our product towards a more of a team building feature, let's say. So that's why we decided what is the most urgent struggle that people are facing right now? That's definitely for companies remote working. Some companies are not really aware of it right now, but I think by the time of next week, we will experience the consequence of working fully remotely. So we decided, okay, let's turn our games into a model that can actually help you assess your entire team on those remote working skills. Absolutely not with the aim who's not a good performer and maybe I should let the person go. Absolutely not. But how to make sure that I can use those results to make my team grow in this situation and to make sure that they can maybe work even more successfully than they would normally do, because of the fact that they are, first of all, aware of the skills they have. And second, for the skills they don't really master, how can I easily get better in mastering those skills? Basically that's what we did. So when companies now work with remotely, it means simply that they let their company, their team members play those games, which takes 15 minutes. And once everyone is finished, you will receive a report from us in which we explain how your team actually performed and for each different team member, what skills to work on and how you can practically work on those skills.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, and you gave some valuable tips for people who run teams. And what recommendations would you give to employees to freelancers, or to anybody who suddenly is separated from their team members? And how can we improve this process by ourselves? For example, if our employer is not very proactive in this, like, what can we do as individuals to improve our productivity?
Yeah, actually quite an interesting question, because most companies are more focused on what can we do as an employer instead of what can employees do. I think that's a consequence of your employer still, but one tip I would give to employees as well, if your company is putting effort in making in getting the best out of this situation, provide your help. So with for instance, if your employer decides to send out surveys, for instance, how you experience remote working and what can be done better, be proactive in filling in those surveys, helping out your manager. That's already half a job, I think. If your company is really not proactive with remote working, I think there are always things that you can do yourself. So if you, I think that many people will experience one of the following difficulties, and that's, I think, either am I productive, yes or no? Am I communicating well with my team? How's my team work with my current team? And to what extent do I still have some social interactions with the rest of the company?
Yeah,
I think productivity is really more of a responsible also of your employer, because your employer should definitely help you with that. Communication is something that you can really work on yourself as well. If your company is not that proactive, you can also suggest yourself some regular check-ins. We, for instance, have 3 times a day a check-in of 5 minutes with the teams to see at the beginning of the day, what are you planning to do today? After lunch, how is it going? Do I need help? And at the end of the day, how was your day? And what do you expect for tomorrow? You can suggest it yourself if your manager is not doing that. And social interaction, we still have online communication channels. I think that everyone is used to sending a WhatsApp message or an email or a Slack message. So also try to contribute yourself. It, of course, it's the job of an employer to facilitate it as much as possible. But I think that we are also in some sort of split in which I see it for myself as a founder of a company. I'm really trying to stimulate my team and to be at the social moments in the video chat and stuff like that. But we are also very busy to keep our business up and running.
Yeah.
So don't expect your employer to do everything for you simply because of the fact that they also need to make sure that the business keeps running and that you can actually work there still within a few months. So yeah, communication, social interaction are two aspects that have proven to be very crucial for remote working. And I think that a lot of that work can be done by yourself as well.
Yeah. Well, and I will ask you the last question for today. So now all of us have been experiencing the corona outbreak, and it's pretty easy to be pessimistic and panic. But what opportunities do you see in this situation for businesses? What advice would you give for business owners and just all of us to take advantage of this time? How can we do that?
Well, I think, first of all, before you even start thinking about advantages, make sure that you're aware of your company status. So being aware of your cash flow and stuff like that. It's really important to know your runway. It's not the most fascinating part, of course, of this discussion, but it is now more important than ever that you're aware of your company's financial status as well, because it also allows you to act on that in terms of marketing budgets, stuff like that. So being aware of what's happening in your company now is definitely a no-brainer. And if you, I think that every founder by now should definitely know, okay, what's my runway? So yeah, that will be my first tip, but that's not a nice one. I think my second one, like I said, celebrate every single success now, even though it's very small. I think that if your company is managing to get a new customer on board, even if it's for a few $100 per month or stuff like that, it's really an achievement, because many companies can't even manage to get new clients on board. So really try to focus on what's going well instead of what's all going wrong, because it's not going to make you more optimistic, and it's definitely not going to help your team. Because if I would get stressed here, I think that my team will notice that within a few days, and they get stressed as well. So I better focus on the things that are going well. And last part, I think that depending on the industry in which you are, 80% of all companies should have some aspect that you can pivot towards a situation that can help you here. Mm-hmm. Either it's something that you can actually earn just some money on, or it's a situation in which you can show some corporate social responsibility by giving away something for free or helping particular people in this situation. So I think there's always something that you can do here. Now is the time that you need to show that entrepreneurs are actually creative thinkers. And I think that everyone who's creative can actually get something out of the situation. And my fourth one there, since operations are slowing down a little bit, I think, for most companies, also use this time to fix some issues that you are postponing for a while now. So I think that it's, I think that many entrepreneurs in times where everything is going well and it's super busy, people tend to keep running and running and running without evaluating how everything is going actually. Use this moment to improve internally as well, to make sure that if your business keeps growing, gets growing again, you are ready for it. So for instance, we decided now from a development perspective in our company, we want to improve a certain feature for a long time now, which is more focused on data structure than actually something that a client can see. So it's not, it's adding value to our customers, of course, but it's not something you will see right away. But now is actually the time to work on that. Now it's a bit less busy because, of course, we expect Corona to be over in a few months and hopefully people start hiring like crazy again. Mm-hmm. It would be actually a shame if our product is not ready for that. So use this time well to evaluate how things are going in your company, and maybe you can find some time to improve certain things that you were postponing for months and months already.
Yeah, well, thank you so much. Thank you. So this will be the end of the part with the interview, and now we will be open for any questions from you guys. So think about your questions now. While you are thinking, I will read some messages from the chat. So Arifa shared a really cool link to of the recent initiative by Gemeente Rotterdam with all the local businesses, all the local initiatives together. So it's definitely a good website to check. And then Bob also shared that Slack has a cool plugin and app to have coffee breaks, as you mentioned before.
Ah, so, I see it, yeah, very cool.
Randomcoffees.com, yeah, thank you for this tip. So are there any questions? Oh, I see one question from Teddy. So the question is, what do you expect or hope specifically will change for aquaculture and for startup economy in general after coronavirus passes?
What I expect to happen, to not be pessimistic but realistic about the situation, is that we already were quite on top of the economy. I think many people already expected a financial crisis to be there somewhere in the next coming years. I think it also results in the fact that things like fundraising and stuff like that was very easy. Very easy is not a good word, but I think the market was full of investors willing to put money in startups. I think startups should expect it to be more difficult to raise funding, which is very unfortunate because, of course, most startups are running on funding, especially in a product company. So my expectation will be that it gets more harder to attract external money for your company, and that means that you should start looking for that earlier, and that you also should be more aware again of your cost structuring and your runway. That's my expectation for the startup economy in general. I also think, unfortunately, that a lot of startups won't make it through the coronavirus. But I think that definitely the ones with a good idea, to keep it also positive, I am sure that the startups with a really great idea, with a really cool team, already proven their business case and have customers on board, should be able to find a way to get some bridge funding and to show their customers now more than ever how valuable they are. So yeah, let's say that we just entered the some sort of the Champions League for startups now. This is the time where we actually need to show that we can do it. So that's what I expect. The really good ones stay. The ones that are facing some difficulties already, I think it's going to be very tricky for them also in terms of financing. What I expect for Equals here is, of course, the growth that we forecasted will not happen, I think, for this year. I think that's something that's happening for every company. But I do think that we have found a way to show our customers that we are really an expert in this field, that we can pivot quite fast to make sure that we can still prove some added value. And I see now already that we still manage to sell our product even in those times. So I expect that everything is going to be fine. Maybe less customers than we forecasted, but I think I am sure that we will definitely make it, so no doubt about it.
Great. There is another question from N. Anand. What are the top three focus areas for organizations, both short and long term?
Ooh,
that's a tough one, I guess.
Yeah, it's a well, here I go again. If we focus on startups, I start with the most boring one again. Finance is the first one. Really focus on you need to pay your team at the end of the month and your office probably and the other costs. So definitely one of the focus areas. And make sure that in those times, finance is not something that you just need to do, but that it's actually a valuable asset for your strategic planning as well. Because, of course, you can also use finance for a cool forecasting and stuff like that. So finance, definitely one of them. People, I should actually mention people before finance, because people are the most important ones here. I think that now is the time to show your current team that you have trust in them and help your current team get the most out of themselves in these times. Because after all, you as an entrepreneur can have an amazing idea, but if you don't have the team to make that dream come true, it will be over quite soon. So make sure that you now give your employees the right trust and the right help and keep them motivated, because it can be quite easy for them to get unmotivated in these times. So that would definitely be my second one. I think my third one, that one might sound a bit crazy, but I'm mentioning it anyway. Marketing is also definitely not something, really something to focus on now. Because I think the advantage that you can get out of this period is that I think there are two ways to respond to a crisis. You can either distance yourself, so really go to the background and hoping that it's over soon, or you can be the first move in the market, showing that you are responding to that situation. And if you do the second thing, companies will get trust in you because you show that you have some guts. So that's really working out, and therefore you should be visible in the market. Being visible is even more important in a time where things are not going so well than in a time where everything is going well, because everyone is visible. So I know that every startup needs to focus on decreasing costs and stuff like that, but at least try to keep some money for marketing expenses to show the world how you are dealing with the situation, because it's really going to enforce your brand later on.
Yeah, I think it's great. So once again, you said finances, number two is team, and number three, marketing. Yeah. There is a question from Arife. How do you handle international candidates when hiring now? I guess getting them to Netherlands and getting the ASN number is impossible at the moment.
Well, it's actually quite a relevant question now, because we having an engineer starting tomorrow, which was living in Poland and was actually planning to come to the Netherlands. So I need to say what we just did is we postponed bringing him to the Netherlands. So he's just starting remotely now, since the whole company is working remotely, and now shouldn't be a challenge to let people start working remotely. Of course there will be some impact. I need to be honest about it. We are still finding out as well what the effect will be on getting a BSN number, but also things, for instance, like you have some discounts on certain taxes if someone lives in the Netherlands and is working for you while he came from abroad. So we still need to find out how it's going to impact that. But I think that the most important thing that we do is, because I think that nobody wants to move anyone now, because of course you also don't know how the situation is going to be in the Netherlands. Maybe it's getting way worse here. And of course, you don't want to have an employee come and live here while things are going pretty wrong. So I would definitely recommend to start with working remotely. Since the whole company is doing it, you might do it for a new employee as well. Make sure that your onboarding is ready for that, by the way. That's very important. Onboarding someone remotely is really something different from doing it offline. And I am sure that there must be a lot of help from the government on how to get those arrangements.
Well, Arife, actually, I know that she works for Rotterdam Partners, and she gave a tip. Please contact our expert center of Rotterdam Partners to discuss collaboration and ask any questions about hiring internationals. There is also a question from Bob on the topic of remote work. You briefly spoke about equipping people with tools to do their work remotely, also a bit about celebrations, COVID meetings, etc. Since culture is broader, what tips do you have for companies that have an office culture and now have to move to a remote culture?
Interesting question, because the term office culture can be interpreted in many ways, I think. I think that a company's culture comes down to a few things. That's the way you the work together, the way you interact with each other, and the goal setting you have for your company. I think those are the three most important things of a company culture. And I think you can still all do that remotely. You just need to make sure that you keep doing it. And I think that the let's frame it differently. I think that the bigger challenge is making sure that you keep touching all those different aspects rather than transforming it to remotely. So it's you can still keep communicating with people, and you can still keep communicating the way you were used to, because you were doing it via video call, but you're still the same person, and you still have the same management style. You can still have social interactions if you facilitate your team to have those conversations with each other. And you still, I hope, have a clear vision for your company and a clear mission and how to execute that mission. So I think the challenge is not so much focused on how to shift my culture, because culture, you definitely shouldn't do that. I think since this is a situation in which we are right now, but maybe it's over in 2 months, make sure that you're aware of what makes your culture attractive for people to work in now, and keep touching those different aspects. Don't forget about social interaction if that's so important for your company culture. So I think that's something that you should be really aware of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. There is another question from Aditya. It could be that really good early stage startups who didn't expect any revenue for the upcoming months, receiving some help from the government is a silver lining. What are your thoughts on this?
Let's start by saying that I think the government is working very hard to get things like bridge funding and stuff like that happening. So yeah, of course, I'm a big startup fan. I think that we should do everything we can to make sure that startups survive these times, because I can fully imagine what you are saying. There are also a lot of med tech startups, for instance, that need to develop products for years before they go to market. And these are the type of companies that I think are going to face some trouble now. So yeah, I'm really a big pro of what can we do also from a government perspective to make sure that those startups get some bridge funding and keep running. And I think that VCs, investment funds as well, shouldn't pause themselves now. I think it's even quite an interesting time for them now to invest, because I think they can get better terms than they would normally get for a startup. But to be honest, I think that since everyone, I think that the most natural response to a crisis for everyone is to hold some stuff, to hold some things, to be aware of your cost and stuff like that. So I think, although I'm hoping it's not going to happen, we should expect that financing will be very hard, and that even if the government is working very hard to make it happen, it will definitely hit some companies, and it will also hit some companies that were forecasted to be funded, and it's not happening now. So, yeah, let's hope that people come with a solution fast, because a lot of startups are really worried. But yeah, I think we should also be aware of the fact that it could be happening, that it's flipping the other way around.
Mm-hmm. There is also another question from Anand. In your experience, are management or the board of the companies receptive of work from home culture? Are they confident of the productivity of such way of work? What are your perspectives on this?
Well, I think there's a challenge for, I think that I mainly spoke about employees in this talk, but I think there's definitely a challenge for management boards and also team leads and all the middle management as well. Because if they don't master the remote working skills, how are you going to help your employees doing it as well? I think that working from home, although it's getting more and more normal for people, there are still a lot of people that are not really used to it and maybe try to avoid it. So yeah, I think that there will be a lot of companies with management teams that are definitely not ready for it and also not so receptive for a working from home culture. That's why we, by the way, also assess the management teams to make sure that they are also aware of their skills. But I think that the good thing is for management teams, of course, they are evaluated by how their team is running. So they need to do everything they can to keep their team running. I think that what they should be more aware of, and that's what I where I started my conversation with as well, is that remote working is not about just the tool stack. It's really about making sure that you now have the right insights to your team. And I think that maybe that's even a bigger challenge. I think that many management teams think they have clear insights into their team. But now it really comes down to having clear insights and not just a gut feeling. And also with people that recently joined your company, for instance, it's not more than normal that people work in your company for 1 or 2 months now. You don't have really clear insights already in what they are capable of and what they need some help with. So I think you should also be really aware of, okay, which employees work long enough in my team to make sure that I have clear insights and where are my blank spots, let's say. I think it's also very, very important to keep in mind.
Yeah. Also, Arife shared in the chat the useful links from Chamber of Commerce for all the businesses getting net impact of the coronavirus. So yep. Amy, there are some very useful links. So thank you very much for that. Well, thank you very much, Charlotte, for your available information on hiring, on remote working.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks, everybody, for joining today. Thank you very much for your questions. I hope it was interesting and valuable for you guys and you learned something. Yes, thank you. Yes, and see you soon. So we are organizing Startup Tuesdays now bi-weekly, and we are having the next session already next Tuesday. So sign up, and we hope to see you next time. Yes.
Yeah, and for people who have any additional questions for me or need some help or just want to brainstorm about something, feel free to send me a message on LinkedIn, and happy to help where we can. And otherwise, I really hope that you find a creative way to keep your company running, because almost every company can get running even in this challenging time. So keep up the spirit. It's not going to stay forever.